Hello and welcome to another edition of Motor Capital. There was some news on ABC about Hitsville, USA, and they talk about a Motown mile. So from Hitsville all the way to Woodward, they're supposed to have a Walk of Fame or something like that. So maybe some stars in the sidewalk. But Marvin Gaye is in the news because of the 50-year anniversary of what's going on. So, okay, Juneteenth, that's what we're officially going to call it. It's a holiday, a federal holiday, the day before President Biden. If he is really our president, we're not quite sure if he was legally elected or if the election was stolen. Just ask any Republican, my Lord, or QAnon conspiracy person. Anyways, enough about politics. We're looking at this house here, and this is where Marvin Gaye lived for like 30 years, kind of in his Motown days. So I don't know if it was his house or if it was parents and then he took it over or what the deal was, but they're going to honor Marvin Gaye by naming a street after him. They're going to rename just this one block section of West Outer Drive. Well, I won't tell you quite yet. We'll have to wait later in the program, and they'll pull back that blue curtain. But they're going to have a press conference, and so they were setting up. Now, I called the Motown Museum, and they said it started at 11, and I thought I was late. It's a good deal. They got a neighborhood watch here. But it didn't start promptly at 11. I don't know. Maybe it was noon. But I called the museum directly and said, what time did it start? And they said 11. And they weren't in any hurry, even though the rain was doing its thing. Luckily, I brought an umbrella. This is the neighbor next door. Now, Marvin had some glass block. I mean, it's a nice-looking house, nice fireplace. Later on, they even introduced the lady that bought the house from the Gaye family. And they love the house. And they're probably going to have a lot more visitors coming by and just taking a peek. Here's some other houses in the neighborhood. This is definitely a very solid neighborhood. No doubt about it. The other side of Livernois, which will be the second half of the show, the Avenue of Fashion. But there's Palmer Woods, Sherwood Forest, and Green Acres. They're solid.
Sit back to front. We've got a few regards that we're holding, but they're in a good place.
It looks like they're getting ready to get it on or whatever, tell people in position. So Fox 2 News, Channel 4. Later on, I saw Channel 7. Security was tight. I mean, there were police officers all over the place. And nowadays, though, geez, oh, Pete, it's so easy for someone to pop out of a car, whip out that AK-47, and take out about 20 or 30 people. It's just ridiculous. We're going back to the wild, wild west days. Here I'm looking at some of the homes. Outer Drive is like a boulevard, so there's a center lane. Look at this. Now, that's a big bush. Let me say that again. That's a big bush. That's what he said. Okay, Avenue of Fashion is just down there. It's three blocks from Marvin's house over to the Avenue of Fashion. Yeah, they had a sound system set up, and they were pumping out Marvin's tunes, which was great. But with the rain, they didn't have a tent, and everything was getting wet. Not a good deal there. They needed some kind of covering, canopy. Well, the Michigan Health, I'll see that truck later. They were given the mobile COVID shots or the vaccine. Yeah, I hit time to kill. I was waiting for this to start, so I'm checking out. This is Marvin's house again, 3067, And part of the family or the people that live there, there's a photographer and taking all number of pictures. It's too bad they didn't give a tour of the house, but I'm sure those people weren't willing to do that. But I guess back in the day, Motown had a bunch of parties in the backyard. Hey, that guy looks familiar. The heavy artillery is out and about. A few well-dressed people. I'm not sure who everybody is. I know Robin Terry. We'll hear her. She's the president. I'm not sure the official title, but she's the spokesperson certainly for Motown Museum and the renovations and the expansion that they're going to go through. Now, this is Marvin Gaye's younger brother, I think 12 years younger, and his wife, and we'll hear him talk a little bit. There's a photo op. Yeah, I'm kind of showing everything. Let's listen in to Robin Terry and see what she has to say.
I'm Robin Terry, the chairwoman and CEO of Motown Museum. Thank you for that. But I do want to just give a special thank you to our co-host today, and that is Councilman McAllister, who sponsored this event. So let's give it up for him. I also want to just give a special thank you to the mayor of this great city, Mike Duggan. I heard best mayor in the United States. And Rochelle Riley. Yes, give it up for Rochelle. Rochelle leads the ACE department for the city of Detroit, and that's arts, culture, training. To dedicate this important intersection, Marvin Gaye Drive. And you could, you guys are making this easy for me. But you couldn't do that without having members of the Gaye family with us. And I just have to tell you how much I love this family. We are very fortunate to have with us tonight, or today, Antoine, who is Marvin's brother. Antoine, would you stand up? And his beautiful wife, Carolyn. And then because Motown is multi-generational, we have his grandson, Dylan. We also have with us, and I just want to make sure I get this right, but First Assistant Chief Bettison with us. And I just want to give it up. Give it up for our men and women in blue, because they made sure that we could deliver this event and that we could do it safely for you, and I just couldn't thank you enough. I absolutely couldn't thank you enough. So we're doing this event on Juneteenth, and I just want to acknowledge the fact that that's so fitting that we're doing this on Juneteenth, because Juneteenth is all about, A, telling your stories. And that's what Motown is about. There's stories, there are people behind these stories of inspiration. So one is about telling your stories, but it's also about freedom and humanity. And when we think about Marvin Gaye's What's Going On album, that's what every track is about. It's about celebrating our freedoms and hoping for freedom and hoping for humanity. So we are also delighted to be kicking off the Juneteenth Jubilee on the Avenue of Fashion. So let's give it up for all those wonderful businesses and those entrepreneurs that line the historic Avenue of Fashion. Motown Museum has been celebrating What's Going On for the entire year. So this is the 50-year anniversary of the What's Going On album. And we kicked off this year in January with the governor on January 20th, and just recognized that as a day of distinction, because that was the day that the album was conceived, that it was released. And then later in May, we had special tours dedicated to celebrating the life story and impact of Marvin Gaye. Well, I'm here to tell you that celebration continues. So today we opened an exhibit called What's Still Going On. So it's still going on. That exhibit is an outside exhibit, free to the community. It spans from West Grand Boulevard in Woodward to the front steps of Hittsville. And it shows us images, historic images from the 60s and 70s, whether they were protest images or whether it was pollution, whatever that cultural issue was that Marvin brought to our attention in 1971, he shows you the things that are still struggles for us in our community. So I encourage you to go see that exhibit. Walk what we call the Motown Mile. It's exactly 1 mile. Walk that mile and be inspired not only by his music, but by these images that speak to what the work we still have to do. So I encourage you to do that when you have a moment. The last thing I wanted to do before expansion that will be a real gift to this community. Absolutely. And we have been very fortunate, and I want to say that out loud. This is a generous community, and we have been fortunate. It is our vision to bring to this community an entertainment and education destination that is second to none. One that serves our children, one that inspires our children to be entrepreneurs, one that undergirds our creative community, helps our young talent who are interested in being in the music business. This is about empowerment. That's what this moment is about. This week was a big week for Motown. And you may have heard we were blessed with a generous gift of $5 million from Mackenzie Scott. And I'm here to tell you that it is such a blessing, but the work isn't done. What Mackenzie Scott's gift helps us to do is to really rebound from a very challenging year last year with this pandemic. So we are not done. I'm here to tell you that. We still got a long way to go, but we're hopeful that gift is going to inspire others to get behind it. So I just want to give you that update and encourage you to stay with us. Keep the prayers going up. We're going to make it to the finish line. But today we are here to celebrate Marvin Gaye and to celebrate this amazing talent that has given so much to the world. When I said before that it's important to tell our stories, Marvin's is one. We have many alumni, many stories, as I mentioned earlier, that need to be told so that our children, our children's children are inspired. And we are fortunate to have with us today also Miller London, one of the early executive vice presidents of Motown. This is the man that integrated sales in the music industry. So we are very fortunate to have him with us. We also have the Funk Brother from Motown. That's the music, absolutely. And others like that. The last alum I just want to mention to you couldn't be with us today, and that's Jim Hendon. Jim Hendon is the photographer who actually shot Marvin's What's Going On album in this very backyard where we're sitting. And so Jim Hendon really wanted to be here with us, and I could not mention his name. So with that, I thank you for your time and attention, and I'm delighted to bring up my co-host, Councilman McAllister.
Brian Stevenson. Brian, where are you? Brian Stevenson.
That fantastic person is Robin Deere. Let's give her another round of applause. So, Councilman Brian, we got to make sure that this is something that is going to be. Reach out to my sister, Simone Carver. She brought in Jeff Cook.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a collaborative effort. I went to the names, and then who comes along and starts an arts and culture? Oh, God! Now, it's raining out here. It's raining out here. So, you know, 50 years ago, Marvin started some things, and he started some things going on. And so this is just coming down from Marvin saying, hey, I'm recognizing you. That's all this is. Somebody said that to me, and I want to thank them because I don't want to. I also got to recognize the chief of the Black Democratic, Keith Williams. Keith Williams. Thank you.
If anybody is having a major event, and you, when Robin Terry took on her mission, she has raised the recognition of Motown to a level where national philanthropists are giving us $5 million. It's going to be amazing. Let's give another hand to Robin Terry for what she's doing. Community is
But what Michelle Riley and Jimmy Settles and Nelson Kelce have done is said, we're going to remind folks, Marvin Gaye was a real person in this neighborhood, and we're going to hopefully be an inspiration to the future. You never know how life is going to turn out. So in the early 1970s, when What's Going On came out, I was a teenager. I was going to high school right down the street on Outer Drive at Catholic Central. Came by here all the time. And if you were my age, this song had meaning. I don't care who you were or where you were. Of course, here in Detroit in 71, 72, we were dealing with a very painful aftermath of the violence in 1967. Those feelings were raw. But the other thing that the album spoke to was the unjust war in Vietnam. And every teenager in this country was thinking when we turned 18 years old, we were going to be drafted, and Marvin Gaye was speaking out against it. So when I was listening to What's Going On, the 13, 14-year-old down the street, I thought he wrote that song for teenagers in the city of Detroit. I realized later that people of all walks of life, all around the world, thought he wrote that song for them. But what I never thought was that every day as I was going by here, Marvin Gaye was in his house where I might have stopped. Now everybody will know that, but the other thing I never could have imagined was that a half a century later, the pain and the division of this country would still be so powerful that What's Going On would resonate in America today. It is a remarkable piece of work, and I am so pleased we are celebrating that, and this street will forever be Marvin Gaye Drive. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mayor Duggan. One more hand clap for Mayor Duggan. Absolutely.
That's so silly. Okay, it is now my pleasure to bring to you Miller London, Motown alumni, to talk to you a little bit about his memories and his reflections on the late
Motown team in 1971 when this project was released. The significance as we stand here today is that 100 years ago, there was an insurrection in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And then 50 years later, Marvin decided to put pen to paper. He and some other incredible writers had come up with What's Going On. The significance at the time was, as the mayor referred to, we were still dealing with riots, insurrections in the city, the Vietnam War, and that was very important to Marvin. He took a huge step in going outside of his traditional music to make a piece of music for the people. And what he did, a protest album. Nonetheless, Marvin persisted. He argued with Mr. Gordon. He argued with even our marketing department about whether or not this project should be released. Somehow, the song got to radio, and I'm going to leave it with somehow. It got to radio. Once it got to radio, it became history. The song was so huge that it was aired nationally in the first week that it was released. This album was also incredibly significant for Motown because we were a company that was known for selling hit singles. We weren't a company that was known for selling albums. And this particular project changed the face of what Motown looked like going into the 70s and the future. We became a company that sold as many albums as we did singles. And it was the result of this project, What's Going On. I was fortunate to be good friends with Marvin over the years and to understand where he was in every project that he did. Even more significant is that here we are 50 years from now, and every word, every lyric, every message is still relevant today. I often ask myself, what does that say for our society? But the most important thing that we have to remember is that the legacy of Marvin Gaye, the legacy of this album, which meant so much to so many people, and it didn't matter what nationality, what religion you were, if you didn't have a Marvin Gaye album in your house, there was something wrong with it. And I say to the young people here that if you're not familiar with the works, go to your parents, your grandparents, and even your great-grandparents, and they'll give you an education. But 50 years later, we're here, and I pray that 50 years from now, that this album will still sustain, not because of what it represented, but because it represented change and where we will be 50 years from now. I thank you all very much.
Miller London.
I'm not about to prepare a message. I just have talking points because sometimes I get nervous and I forget. How y'all doing, everybody? How you doing? Thank you so much for this honor to my brother. It's just a wonderful thing. I'm just sitting back and just listening to people and taking it all in, and it is just a blessing to be here. I thank God for the opportunity. Thank you for listening earlier. I thank God for the opportunity to be here. I didn't know that when the album was made, 1971, I was 1 year old. 1 year old. So just to be here on this day, it's just a beautiful thing that God knew that I'd be here. And I just blessed. I want to first say that this is my beautiful wife, Carol. Yeah. I thank her for her love and kindness. The children, to know. It's important to know that the balance of things. When you love your neighbor, you don't care about their voting rights and not try to suppress them, but you love your neighbor. I'm gonna mention something. In the song, he said, Jesus left a long time ago and left us a book to believe in. And in it, we have a lot to learn. I want to mention something. In Proverbs, it says, open your mouth for the dumb, for those unable to speak for themselves, for the rights of all those who are left desolate and defenseless. Open your mouth and judge righteously and administer justice for the poor and needy. That there is sacrifice. There's something bigger than just making money. There's something more important than just being trying to be famous or just making money or whatever. What about the children? Yeah. Let's save these babies. Yeah. Let's save these babies. My name is Antoine Gay. I thank you for your time and I just thank you for your time. Thank you so much.
Almost 48 hours ago, I was in the White House watching the President of the United States signing a national holiday commemorating Juneteenth.
Yeah! Juneteenth!
All of the words and things and documentaries I've been watching, one stood out to me. It was a little boy who had a sign. He said, they tried to bury us, but they didn't realize we were seeds. We were seeds. That everything that happened to us, from slavery, from the Jim Crow, the civil rights violations, and still today, we are thriving and we are growing and we have a legacy. And a couple things I just like to reinforce. When we talk about oppress us. They took away education, and to everyone here, we should be tearing down the doors to every school we can get in. Because they knew if we were ignorant and we did not have education, we would not thrive. They took away our ability to vote. And I know this is about us as a people. We're celebrating, and I want you to cook some wings and drink a beer, do whatever you want to do. But I understand the significance of this moment.
Amen.
The Jewish people have a saying when they sit down at the holidays and say, why is this day different from other days? Why is today Juneteenth different? Because today is the day was the beginning. It was the beginning of taking back what we was taken from us. And we are our ancestors. ancestors' greatest dreams and opportunity, we will tear it up. When we get the opportunity, educate me and I'll show you the person who can change the world.
Unveiling, so that this space becomes Marvin Gaye Drive. So I'm gonna ask all of our dignitaries on the stage to please join me at the street center. I thank you so much for enduring this rain.
Oh, the tension is building. Soon they will be unveiling the renamed West Outer Drive section here. And they're doing it on both sides of the street. So part of the media crew is going to the north side of Outer Drive. And the main, the celebrities, the VIPs are here on the south side, but we'll watch them pull the blue curtain back. I mean, this is what everyone's waiting for. I probably could have shortened this whole thing down to about 30 seconds, but yeah, the speeches were interesting. You know, learned some things and so forth, and I followed Motown, so it was nice hearing what they say. But this was past history. We really do need to recreate or not recreate. We need to create new history and develop that new talent. And Robin Terry addressed that a little bit. The next generation and whatnot, there's people that want to get into the music business. Hello, let's help them out. You know, lightning can strike twice. But yeah, I was wondering, they were getting real set up and I think it was getting caught. All right, let's see, they got up. Pulled a curtain back from the post there. But yeah, this is Juneteenth. It is a holiday, a paid holiday for federal workers. Okay, let's see if they're, it's starting to rain pretty decent too. Well, not real bad, but still it's nice with here. We're getting close. The umbrella came in handy for sure. On it a little bit there, but I think we're gonna get it here shortly.
What's going on? It's stuck up there.
There we go. Shortly after 12 noon on Juneteenth, the dedication of Marvin Gaye Drive. How about it? A decent crowd. They, the paper said like 100 people. I would say a couple hundred. I didn't count them, but there we go. So that's a nice way to commemorate Marvin. And God, they should do this with other houses too. Have a tour like they do in Vegas of superstars or Hollywood or what is it? Around LA, there's the ritzy things. They drive by and show you the where the stars hang out. But yeah, they could do that in Detroit. All right, now nothing left but the photo ops. So yeah, let's see if we can get in on a picture or two here. Oh, and I spoke with the neighbor here. She was real nice. I like her flowers, but she was sitting out in front of her garage, and I asked her, yeah, she's there with sitting down. She likes the neighborhood. She likes her home. I asked her if it was okay to walk on the grass. She said, fine. Yeah, she says, it's not like I'm going to stop anybody. So I thought I'd be polite, though. But, yeah, there was police trying to keep people off, cordon off, but, yeah. someone took the microphone away. Anyways, with the rain coming down, that was it for the music. I was bumming because, yeah, I could listen to Marvin it playing in the background all day long. There's Coleman Young Jr., so he was even getting in on the action. He didn't speak to the crowd, but... yeah, Antoine Marvin's brother, he said he was born like in 19... or 1 year before the album came out, so 1970. So I'm wrong. He's probably about 20 years the junior of Marvin. I'm not sure when Marvin was born, but probably around 1950 or so. I'd have to look. But, yeah, there were people with the T-shirts. Robin sporting one there. There's a Channel 4 umbrella. Yeah, this is the audio guy, and yeah, he just like pulled the plug on all that. It's like, no, that's not good for the equipment. Then they have the electrical box, and I don't think that's ever a good thing, having it exposed to rain like that. It's like, you know, just things blow up. Here's the entrance to the black backyard. Now, trust me, I was so tempted to take a peek just to see if it was laid out, like maybe if there was a pool back there and they would have some crazy parties and so forth. But it's a nice house. I wonder how many bedrooms and like the layout. Detroit Entertainment Commission. So they seem like they're doing some good work in Detroit. I mean, we need to... yeah, Detroiters like to have fun, so yeah, let's promote the entertainment scene, and that includes all the live music. There were reporters interviewing people, and yeah, there's the rain. They say we're short on the rain this year, like 4 inches, but now they're saying we might make that up this coming weekend. It's supposed to rain. Well, it rained Wednesday, which is just when I'm doing the voiceover, June 23rd. Look at the chicken and waffles. We'll see that. But, yeah, I parked a few. Marvin's place is just 3 blocks from Livernois, but I parked on Pennington. Free parking. Now, you see Sherwood Forest. There's the University District, the Bagley neighborhood, which is what we're in now. Green Acres is near 8 Mile. A beautiful, solid neighborhood. All right, so we're going to check out that chicken and waffles. There's a Bucharest Grill. Yeah, the Avenue of Fashion. So we're gonna do that. Here, I like the artistic style of the cement work. Not so much above the window there, but... I parked near Louis Pasteur School. This is entrance number 3. And, you know, with rental cars being so pricey, I think I heard that some people were renting, like you all, for the day and so forth. It might be actually cheaper. Well, full steam ahead. That's the Bucharest. But, yeah, the Juneteenth celebration, it was kind of... hurriedly planned or whatnot. They didn't have much time, but they decided, you know, it was signed into a holiday. What was it? It was signed on the 18th, but they already made plans that the Avenue of Fashion is going to do it up. Now, this was from the past election, but they still got Cherie up there. Now, along the Avenue of Fashion, there's room for improvement. We're talking urban planning here, and this is like the black shopping district, the upscale shopping. And when they talk about black entrepreneurs and the like, they always point to this neighborhood. Now, we could have many more neighborhoods like this throughout the city and promote them. That's all urban planning, and I'm all for that. I'll promote it as much as I can, because I think that's going to be the growth of Detroit. And good times if we promote urban planning. Here, the nice sign, like a woodcut Bagley, and they were established in 1961. So yeah, that's looking down Outer Drive, and the tent's still set up, but they're still in the process of taking things down. But I'm going to walk down to 7 Mile and then swing back up to 8 Mile. Good Cakes. Now, I've been in here before. They were part of the Detroit Soup. If you've never heard about them, they're a group that is like bread and soup and so forth, and people that have business ideas for Detroit pose it to the community, and then people vote democratically. Everybody gets one vote.
Sorry.
And they get whatever they raise, usually around $500. But anyways, I saw the bakery. This is Cuzzo's, and this, well, the carryout side. Then the other side was the dining area, but that place has been popular ever since they opened. All right, Black Lives Matter. So they have a little parking area. I was trying to read the sign, and then it's... okay, well, Avenue of Fashion. Yeah, I never read that whole mural. But there's wide sidewalks. They redid this, and they got the green light here. That helps you if you're... I don't know if that means they have cameras, but I believe that's what it is. So if you're ever feel threatened somehow and you want something to be on videotape, go to the green light. This is a mural that's got started. I guess it's halfway through or thereabouts. Whether they're going to finish, who knows. Place coming soon, the Energy Zone. I'll show you a few quick things of the music. I'll go into that music cafe a little bit later on. There's some businesses, tax places and other small businesses, beauty places. All right, so I headed south to 7 Mile, and it even continues a little further. But look at the nice wide sidewalks, and they have the bike lane. Some of the ladies' clothing here, pretty colorful stuff. Pretty fashionable stuff, I should say. But so it's, I like that. Jubilee. So anyways, they printed up these posters. A lot of people or sponsors got involved. And it made the news. Okay, this is the music cafe. And I saw, oh man, they're set up. And I asked perchance if they had any live entertainment scheduled. And she said, yeah, come back at 2. And so it was like 1 o'clock at the time. So I said, I can do that. I think that would work. But so, yeah, gospel there and maybe a little blues, a little jazz. I don't know. I'm a blues fan. Blues number one. All right. This place was popular. Fork in Nigeria. Yeah, swing around and we'll take a look at the menu. Some of that stuff looks real good. I could see myself doing that, some of those things. But then there's the line. All right, Sherwood Forest, that very solid community. Your vote is your power. Yes, well, they're trying, the Republicans don't want, like, fair voting. They want to, they felt 2020, it was a stolen election. Oh, Lord. Lordy, lordy. Our democracy is in peril right now based on what the Republicans are doing. They don't want you to vote. Well, especially if your melatonin is it higher? I think it's higher level of melatonin. They don't want those people voting. If you're lily white, you're good to go. Look at the nice flowers here. And this, they're not open yet. I was talking to the nice lady. She may be a co-owner. But here we're going to have Motor City Brewing Works. And I believe this is edition number 2. They have one in the Midtown area. And so this will be their second location. They were just waiting on the liquor license. Now, this is supposed to be all black entrepreneurs, but I think the Motor City, they may have done some gentrification, and there might be a white entrepreneur here or there. But we're talking about diversity, right? That's a good thing, isn't it? I think so. Okay, I'm heading north up to 8 Mile. I want to see Baker's Lounge. Look at the lights here. That's the first time I believe I've seen this, but red, yellow-green traffic lights for the cyclists for their bike lane. This guy's kind of blocking the bike lane there. That's a no-no. Okay, well, we're going to have a mayoral election. So Mike Duggan had a display. We'll see three or four other signs. I think that Good Times Bar does a pretty good business. They could use a few more nightclubs along the way. 313, they're playing off the area code. All right, back to Bucharest Grill. I stepped inside and they were doing a brisk business. Anthony Adams, he's another person running for mayor. So I think the primary is like in August, and then in November, it'll be the general election. All right, there's a church across the way. Here, ABC TV came from the celebration for Marvin. They came out here, and somebody, I don't know how long this mural's been up, but people were taking photographs in front there. What's going on? And it is, like they said, it is still relevant today. People ask, yeah, I mean, there's any number of issues that you could definitely say that for. How about climate change? That's one. All right, well, look at the flower beds here, but that's going to require some maintenance. Now, they had some talk show, so it was a live podcast.
Yeah, we are going to read it.
Absolutely.
First, you
we all got a lot.
I think this was like the main registration area. I probably should have gone in just to see if they had a program or talked about it a little more. Plumbing service. I like some of the signs that they have. I like advertising signs. Here's one of these flower beds. There's some weeds interspersed in here. I mean, it really does take some maintenance. You got to do it year in and year out. And there's plenty of these flower beds, but they're kind of looking like they're a little overgrown. So, you know, that block is going to have to pay for a maintenance guy or whatever to do that. Here, Fahrenheit 313, so they're really playing off the 313 area code. A lot of cities across the country seem to pick up on that. But 313 was one of the first, I believe. Now, they were shooting three-pointers here, or a three-point contest. I don't know what kind of prizes you would get. Now, here, the Gripper. I've been by here a couple times, and they've been closed. So I said, no, they got to be open. This is a regular Saturday. So I'm looking at it. The famous spicy young Gripper. That's what I ended up with. But they have some other ones here. And people rave about their chicken sandwiches. So like they're $12. They rave about Popeyes. And I think Chick-fil-A. There's Burger King even has one now, and McDonald's. They're all on the chicken thing. But that was a great sandwich. So I placed my order, and here's Baker's Jazz Club. And it's under surveillance, so no funny business here, but they're closed. Or, well, they don't open till 4 p.m. But there's the website, the phone number, the address, you know, and their hours. World's oldest jazz club. Okay, Channel 7 gave up, but no, Motor Capital goes on. Here, Art and Maya. Here's two other people running for mayor. Now, you can get here by bus, and the 8-mile bus is 17. So, an 8-mile is M-102. I believe that's considered would that be a county road or a state road? It's probably state. Okay, Green Acres. I love the name of this neighborhood. So this is just south of 8 Mile and then going east towards Woodward. And they're hiring. I always thought, hey, that's great. Okay, I got my carryout. I always thought that'd be a great job to have. This they call College Park Station. I like the logo, too. All right, this is the place, but they're not in state, but they make the nice benches here. I like them. But look how wide the sidewalk is. They took up a lane of the street. Instead of two lanes both ways, they just have one. So at times, it can get very crowded. This building, quite a big building here, Fred's Unique Furniture, that's for sale. And then Hangovers, the door was open, but they were doing some remodeling. I wanted to sit down and enjoy my chicken sandwich, but it's like, crap, I can't even have a drink with this. So I'm walking back to the car. Belvedere used to have a, remember Belvedere Construction, Tyler 8, 7100 or whatever? They had a group, you know, some tent setups. So, and there was the health station. So if you wanted the vaccine, it could be done. Made it back to the car, DET.com. Okay, there we go. I wanted to dig in. And it came with Parmesan fries, and those were really tasty. So here I'm digging in. It is quite the sandwich, and you need napkins, too. I made a little bit of a mess.
That you have to pay for the poison-filled water you keep drinking. That you have to pay for the poison-filled air you keep breathing.
Okay, little speeches, and then some painting, and now some music. I said I got to make it back, so here we go. Got waffles here too. I guess that's the thing, waffle and chicken, but they got other things. It's looking tasty. A nice venue here. Be the change you wish to see in the world. Mr. Gandhi. Yes, I love that quote. Good to hear live music again. I love it. And here's a nice quote too. Yeah, and just down the street from that, they had a dance studio. And look at this, national champions in 2014. They had a stage set. Well, here's a little further progress on the art scene. I like the color palette here that he's got. And a rose with the D. And here, the Charter County of Wayne. We produce, we defend freedom of man. Okay, that's it, folks. Thanks for watching. Have a good evening. Good night.